Good morning. Good morning. You're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano, and we have our current lineup, the usual ones here, I believe. Tom Choske there, Tom?
Yep. Doing good, okay. How you doing?
Great, great, great. How about you?
Hanging in there, surviving the quarantine.
Okay. Well, we also have Scotty Boman. Scotty, you there?
Hello. Yes, I am. Okay.
Great, 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 great. Also, we have Police Commissioner Willie Burton. Willie, you there?
Good morning. How you feeling?
I am doing great. So we got a packed lineup here this morning. We got Mr. David Helms, who's coming to update us on some of the litigation that's happening with the state of Michigan, although the governor has loosened up on some of the stay-at-home orders that she issued this week. It's kind of interesting. If you look at the two newspapers this morning, Detroit News and the Free Press, are coming from complete opposite directions on the governor and what she's done. The Free Press has a glowing piece about what she's done in the national spotlight, and then the Detroit News with Nolan Finley and the rest of them have pretty well said that she needs oversight in terms of the legislature in issuing some of those orders and things like that. So, Scotty, I know you've been a big proponent of constitutional rights and that they don't really shrink at a time like this, even though there's a health challenge, obviously, with the virus that is out there. So any thoughts on what you've seen about, you were active in some protests virtually. I don't know how big of an impact they have, but at least it's a safe way of doing it and still exercising some constitutional rights. Why don't you tell us about it?
Well, actually, there are a couple of different protests, and back on March 28th, I was actually one of the first protests out there in Lansing, where actually we're keeping a good distance and wearing protective clothing, and then when the news stations did show up, we had banners and signs, and we were at the Capitol protesting violations of the state and federal constitution. But then on other occasions, since then, my protest involvement has been virtual, and that's been online in local government. But the thing in Lansing, it was like the follow-ups, we would have liked to have larger numbers of people still keeping a good distance from each other, but unfortunately it turned into a Trump rally, which I'm kind of glad I didn't show up at.
that's what in Lansing, right?
Yeah, I don't want to mix the issues of a rather strange candidate for president and who's also incumbent and the core issues. But we also were protesting in the promotion kind of in limbo of Dwayne Jones at the Board of Police Commissioners again. The board did come up with a letter against some of the things he had done, but I don't know if they're actually going to be following through with the court challenges, and I guess there is an avenue to do that, so their attorney, Fyrick. So he's been involved in a few different protests.
Well, the police commission has had some controversial calls as of late. One is the promotion of to sergeant of the individual involved in the DMC matter. And also, one of the members on the executive team got like a 28% pay increase when the city of Detroit is dramatically cutting back on its employees and furloughing. Some employees, they keep their health care, but their salaries are cut like 90%. So, Willie, I know I'm sorry, what?
Oh, I said Commissioner Burton, he shined quite a light on that they were getting raises perhaps where they weren't best placed.
Well, I think that this is the wrong time where the Board of Police Commissioners should be given pay raises when the mayor already made an announcement of cutting approximately 3,000 employees, city employees. It sends the wrong message anytime the Board of Police Commissioners can give someone a $23,000 pay raise when everybody else is cutting back. I think it sends the wrong message. I definitely against the pay increase. because I feel like you know, the interim position for chief investigator for the board, I think that we should be looking for someone to come in to fill that role instead of giving somebody a $23,000 pay increase. I think it's just preposterous, a waste of money, waste of spending.
Now, you especially when they were already funding. Willie, you get your funding from the city of Detroit, don't you? I mean, are you a line item in the Detroit budget, or how does that work?
Yes. So basically, in the city of Detroit's budget, the Board of Police Commissioner's office has approximately a $4 million budget, and that's to manage staff. So we actually have 20 investigators that work for our office. Just recently, Lawrence Arpark was a supervisor investigator for the board. He was making $82,000 a year. So for the position for interim, it's $79,000 to $129,000 with the pay scale. So he was already working within that pay scale, even for the interim position. If there was no need to give him a $23,000 pay increase, but once again, we need transparency on the Detroit Board of Police Commission.
Tom, how do you think the governor's handled everything this week? She's come under some criticism, but she seems to have scaled back on some of the requirements. There are a lot of people holding their breath on how this opening up of the states are going to actually work. She seems to be faring better than Trump, President Trump, because he actually skipped the Corona press conference or update last night. A lot of GOP members feel that he's hurting them, and he's hurting them so bad that it might even reflect on them losing the U.S. Senate and what's going on. So any thoughts on how you think the governor's doing and what she's doing right? And if we're going to have a guest, David Helm is going to come on, who's going to also has challenged some of the executive orders and has filed some additional lawsuits in regard to that. He's going to be on at 8:30. So you have any thoughts on how the governor is doing at this point?
Yeah, I tell you, Bob, it is an absolutely crazy time when we have to be telling people, don't drink bleach. When the president goes on TV and says that's how you kill coronavirus, it's crazy that we have to tell people, don't drink bleach, it will kill you. But, you know, what the governor's doing, especially in contrast to what we're seeing out of Washington, D.C., is very strong. She has a very strong response. And a lot of this response is not only helping us in the state of Michigan and us throughout the country get through this, it's also building her resume in the eyes of the Joe Biden campaign for potentially bringing her on the ticket as a Democratic VP. She's been handling this crisis with executive orders that while they may have some extreme measures, there's also at least a reason for some of that. Now, of course, like you said, Attorney Helm is going to be on, and he's going to talk about why there may be some legal components to that and differing legal opinions of her power. But politically, she's coming off very strong. The majority of Michiganders, even a good chunk of Republicans, respect her for her strong action. And this is something that is helping us. But then, too, when we look at November and the fact that our country is going to continue on and we are going to need to go through and choose our president for the next 4 years, you know, the Joe Biden ticket is looking at this and saying, well, Governor Whitmer is showing the kind of leadership that we're going to truly need in this country to really bring us together, especially after what we've seen these last 3.5 years from Donald Trump.
Tom, or the rest of the panel, what do you think about the oversight committee that the legislature is creating in regard to these executive orders and things like that? If they're trying to pass a bill, there's actually two statutes. And in our first guess might get into this, but there's two statutes that she's operating under. One is from 1945 or 47 with her emergency powers, and then the second one was actually passed in 76. And I think it's sort of fascinating to me that here you had legislation that put in emergency managers, and talk about dictation, that emergency managers had ultimate power over cities and budgets and everything else. And it didn't, and there was even a referendum that blocked some of that that was passed by the voters, and the legislature turned right around and revamped the law and continued on with emergency managers. It's sort of hypocritical now for them to be worried about oversight when they had placed in the power people that had no oversight in what they were doing, and we saw what it led to, places like the six-year anniversary of the Flint water crisis.
Well, I think we have due to have some checks and balances up there in Lansing, and I'm glad that they're doing that. There need to be more, but I think some of this pressure is the reason that the governor has moderated some of the restrictions regarding businesses being open. And I've been saying all along that we could have almost all businesses open, and not necessarily every single one, but almost all of them open, while still being safe if they just practice enough cautions. One of them is keeping people separated. Another one is personal protective equipment. Another one is limiting entrance into the building, is having people go on in at all. Curbside service is a good idea. So I see some of that coming into play. And the idea of letting the business owners regulate the employees. And if the employees don't do things right, then, I mean, that regulate the customers, I have to say. And if the customers aren't acting right, well, then they can just, you know, kind of shut the door on them. I think that's overall been having some positive results.
You know, Bob, I'm a... Go ahead, Willie.
You know, I'm a strong supporter of oversight on the local and state level, and even on the federal level. We need oversight in this country. You know, without oversight, who's going to be in charge of the checks and balances?
You know, I support what Commissioner Burton said. I definitely am a big fan of oversight and transparency. I love it. My concern, and this is, Bob, something you kind of alluded to earlier, talk about the emergency managers. Why were the Republicans so concerned about protecting emergency managers from scrutiny, but they want to give this governor so much scrutiny? I don't think that this move specifically is about oversight. I think it's about politics. And so that's the only reason that I'm opposed to it. And I'm very glad that the governor said she's going to veto it. Now, I just want also all of our folks out there listening to know that, Bob, you mentioned the two different statutes in Michigan law that deal with emergency powers. The 45 one and the 78 one, or 72, 1970s. There's only one of those two laws that gives legal immunity to our medical workers, and that is the 1970s law. That's currently what we're using right now for the governor's emergency powers. That's what's allowing doctors who may not have all their certifications in certain aspects of medicine to basically volunteer their time and legally treat folks with COVID and other complications. If the legislature doesn't act, and if the legislature forces the governor to veto this oversight bill, and we have to revert back to the 1945 Emergency Powers Act, that's going to create a legal challenge for our medical workers. Could be a great payday for some trial lawyers, but also could endanger some of the health care that Metro Detroiters are receiving.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be a bad time to try to sue people with when they're trying to act in the sense of the emergency. And I know some of the medical schools are just accelerating, allowing some of the medical staff, the graduates, to really take on the challenge early and go into some of the hospitals. We do have some callers on the line. Let's start with Mr. Positive. Mr. Positive, you're on, 9:10 a.m.
Hey, good morning, you guys. I think Governor Whitmer is taking some proper measures, but I think her oversight could be extended, like everyone's saying, to other businesses, with the caveat of being more, you know, just being more cautious. You do it. You can make it happen. I believe that she's somewhat grandstanding. She'll tell you that she doesn't want to become vice president, but you know that she does because she's on every media outlet there is known to a man, you know, and she's always articulating that she only wants to get the news out. But you go on MSNBC or CNN or some obscure other station, and Detroit or Michigan is not really privy to that outlet. You know, she is definitely grandstanding, and she does want to become vice president. Don't let anyone kid you. But all in all, I mean, if you can open up certain areas of the economy, you know, you can use for
I was sort of surprised she went on MSNBC and some other places like that and were announcing some of the policies there versus announcing Michigan residents and things like that. I was a little surprised at that, but, you know, she does have a high profile, and, you know, Trump has elevated her profile one way or another. That's part of it. Mr. Posit, what do you think about this oversight committee that the legislature is establishing?
I'm not too familiar with it, so as the program goes on, I'll get more informed. But, no, I just don't know about it. No, what is it again, real quick, Bobby?
It's an oversight committee established by the legislature. I think it has, it's supposed to be nonpartisan, but because Republicans actually control the legislature, there's more Republicans. There's 10 members, and I think probably 7 of them or 6 of them at least are Republicans, 4 or the other remaining ones are Democrats. But it's supposed to be an oversight, and I think what it's going to start to do is also look at some of the policies that the governor's implemented. Regarding this, for example, I know that they're looking at that contract that she said that was a distraction, the one that was supposedly was going to go to a Democratic vendor that uses the information a lot of times for some of the campaigning for Democrats. And in fact, I think he was the one who said somebody should give the virus to Trump that he had posted, and obviously she right away pulled the contract back. It was done through Health and Human Services, and I think they're going to look at that. I don't know. Obviously, it's going to become very political in the way that they look at it. But part of it, she set up the task force for the minority task force, she called it, I believe, or for people of color that seem to have disproportionate amount of the virus that's hitting within their community when you look at Detroit and some of those other areas. So the oversight is going to be, I'm guessing it's going to be very aggressive in looking at some of her policies with it. So,
With my cursory understanding, Bobby, I think it sounds like it's a good thing because any oversight, anybody watching somebody else, to see if they're on the up and up. The more minds you have, obviously, the more chances you get to the truth. I'm reading a book about that very concept, people making decisions as opposed to one. You should have groups of people that put input in, and it makes it more logical, or you get to the truth a little bit better. That's a great show, you guys. Have a good one.
Oh, thanks. Bye. Appreciate it.
You know,
we have a couple of callers on. Go ahead.
You know, Governor Whitmer, she really raised her profile when she hired Mayor Pete, PRA, PR person. And so she definitely sounds like she, you know, out trying to become a VP for Biden. You know, it is what it is.
I hear the music. Hang on. We're going to be back. We have 2 or 3 calls on the line. We'll get to you right after we get back. You're listening to 910 AM Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano, along with Police Commissioner Willie Burton, Tom Choske, and Scotty Boman. We'll be right back.
Yes. Let me talk to you. See, when it feels like the sun ain't shining bright enough, it's like the devil's trying to work to give an idol up. And though I'm blessed, I still gotta handle the things I go through. It's good to have a friend with another perspective to show you. Someone you know that knows you.
Central Park Deli on Losser between 8 and 9 Mile Road is serving everything fresh and delicious. Open Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. and Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. Central Park Deli will deliver to businesses from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. daily. At Central Park Deli, you will enjoy our hefty sandwiches, our delicious soups made fresh daily, our fresh, made-to-order stir-fried dinners, and the best roll-up sandwiches in town, and a variety of meats such as club, buffalo chicken, Italian, Greek, hot corned beef, veggie roll-ups, and more. Central Park Deli offers a great dining experience, fast and efficient carryout, and fantastic tray catering for special events. Central Park Deli makes ordering your food in advance fast and easy with our new online platform and mobile app. Central Park Deli on Losser between 8 and 9 Mile Road is serving everything fresh and delicious.
Brought to you by the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services. Do your part to slow the spread of COVID-19 by staying home and staying safe. Learn more at michigan.gov/coronavirus.
Are you getting the most out of your Medicare plan? Are you sure? Many people with Medicare are eligible for plans that include extra benefits in addition to those found in original Medicare. Benefits like dental, vision, and prescription drug coverage. Call now to see if you're eligible to enroll. The consultation is free with no obligation to enroll. In addition to hospital and medical coverage, at no extra cost, you could also get coverage for prescription drugs, dental, hearing, vision, and more. In many areas, plans with benefits are available with $0 copays for many services, $0 monthly premiums, or $0 deductibles. That's hospital, medical, prescription drug, dental coverage, and more included in one plan with premiums that may be as low as $0 a month. Call now to see if you're eligible to enroll. The consultation is free and there's no obligation to enroll.
Call 1-800-571-8580. That's 1-800-571-8580.
Listen up, America. Are you or a loved one suffering with an addiction to alcohol, opiates, prescription painkillers, or other drugs? There is hope. Medication-assisted treatment is proven most effective for opiate addiction recovery. Utilizing medications such as methadone, Suboxone, and Subutex, combined with inpatient treatment, you can achieve lasting recovery. Most insurance is accepted, so call us now.
Please call 800-625-5860.
So, you've decided to go to college. That's cool. So, pop quiz. Which is a better way to earn your degree? Commute to college and fill your gas tank, get stuck in traffic, drive in bad weather, try to find a parking space, walk a half mile to class, or learn online at Independence University. You don't go to college. College goes to you. That's Independence. That's Independence University. And all your supplies, including a brand new laptop and tablet, are included with tuition. Independence U for an independent you.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Do you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS? If so, you may qualify for the IRS's Fresh Start Program. The Fresh Start Program is one of the biggest tax breaks the IRS has offered. Call Tax Group Center at 800-685-6150 to see if you qualify for the IRS's Fresh Start Program. Their team of tax experts and attorneys will get you the best tax settlement possible. Call 800-685-6150 now to learn if you qualify for the IRS's Fresh Start Program. Call Tax Group Center at 800-685-6150. 800-685-6150.
Pull out your smartphones and tablets right now and follow the hottest station in town. That's right, 910 AM Superstation is bringing the conversation to social media. Search us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Periscope.
Good morning, you're listening to 910 AM Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. And have our usual panel with us, which is Willie, Scotty, and Tom. You can join us, by the way, at 313-778-7600. That's 313-778-7600. I believe we have some callers that have been on hold. We promised you after the break, so we'll get to you. So, Rick, you're on with the panel.
Hey, good morning to everybody on the panel. I just wanted to bring up a couple of observations here because it just appears to me that, you know, perhaps some of my city paid advocates are in sleepy time. When you hear about things, contact tracking, right? When you see private investors willing to put money up to ensure our health, I don't doubt that, right? I think it could be a great idea. But the line of private-public there is being crossed, and it's worth $1 trillion. I'm just saying, turning private consumer products into tools for policing and medicine is big money, right? And we're not even suggesting, confused. Like I said, a lot of my advocates are in sleepy time, and I don't know why. Not even asking to establish a Michigan Data Relations Fund, because we're talking about inadvertently and without public caucus handing over the ability for Microsoft to use a phone you bought for another purpose. It's giving you options. It's giving them options. I ain't got a problem with that. But we're talking about more than $1 trillion. And I'm seeing a minimum for Michigan of $50 to $100 million. I'm seeing the city of Detroit being able also to get the monies from that relationship. It's only fair. And whatever happened to
Rick, the problem you might have is that I don't know if government has technology developed. When you're talking about Google, when you're talking about some of the others, only they at this point seem to have the ability to develop this type of technology. I don't know. Let's say you don't want the private companies in it. How do you develop the technology that they've, let's face it, they've been able to do?
How about we charge them for the license, Bob? How about off the rip? You know, we understand they have technology that they built, tried, and tested on us, that they sold to us and made money to research and develop. Oh, we understand the connection there, okay? So what we're saying is for that license, to do that data relationship, the public, the citizens should get something. We all become sales in a process that is going to enrich a company that's already among the richest monopolies in the world, and you're telling me I should consider something else. I'm not there. We need to get them in a situation of a data relationship. We need a data relationship fund. First off, you're talking about going into much of this stuff without any known oversight. And I talk to people all the time. A lot of you guys wouldn't understand how to, really monitor that data anyway. And I'm saying you're going in without any bureaucratic oversight, without any fund set up to check into public complaints. And that's why we have Make3.com, and the reason that in totality, our collectors have over $1 billion of what? Insurance against error. And see, what they're doing is trying to offer you something and not even telling you the fine print, and they want the public to just go for it. And I'm saying it's fine. I'm for using technology. I'm for advancement. But I'm also for fair equity when it comes to data, because that data ultimately will start to work itself in forms of AI and other things. So I just want to raise that, because I think we missed some of this. All right, thanks.
Okay, thanks, Rick. We appreciate it. We also have Tony on the phone. Tony, are you on?
Yes, how y'all doing this? Well, I come in late on the conversation, but what I'd like to say is that I'm listening to all these different things we would do to avoid this virus and everything, but I'm not hearing anything about the disrespect and illegal what these Chaldeans is doing while in our community liquor store. Liquor stores don't have no separation, no distance. People pile them up on the counter. They don't disinfect everything. They lie on this. Our people, we will never control this virus in the black community. This is a damn pandemic. So the hell with what the law says. They shouldn't be able to sell liquor in our community, killing our people like this. Young people go in these stores, they're selling this liquor. Look at this one store. We're talking about Cognac Castle on Hopper at Nottingham, on Hopper Street. They don't allow this man gives a party the last year on his lot. Right to this day, he studied allowing these parties on his lot. Where they negligated, we're talking about hundreds of people piling up. And no one is caring. These people not wearing no masks. They going in and out of his store. He allowed them to be piled up on the counter. This one liquor store, you got Coney Islands on 6 Mile. allowing people inside there, 10 to 15 people at the counter order. He does never close this place down. I noticed something, when things affect us, it's always got to be, we're talking about a law. This is a damn pandemic. The hell with the law. This needs to be stopped. The leaders must come together. We got to stop these liquor stores right now while this pandemic going on. The, I know it's always about the law, what affects us, is the law, what we can or cannot do. What the Grand Horn doing? We have never controlled the pandemic in our community alone. We rely on this. You got to see the disrespect. They don't even clean it.
Sir, you know, liquor was illegal before, and there were a lot of side and spillover problems as a result of that. So bringing back prohibition, and by the way, I guess on a county level, that's constitutionally
illegal. But there's no oversight. It's a pandemic. It should be an oversight.
It's going to create even more crime, and I don't know that having criminal speakeasies and that kind of thing pop up like we had back in the 1930s is really going to help it with any pandemic management.
Well, doesn't it sort of raise the question that Detroit PD and some of the other ones, the rules are pretty strict on how many people are supposed to be in a location, how they're supposed to have social distancing and things like that. If there's a particular
oversight enforcement in liquor stores, though, because it was set to black community, I know there's never no oversight or no concern. Who's going to do this liquor store? This is a pandemic.
I know that, but Detroit PD somehow has issued like 700 tickets, for violations of the executive order. So I would presume that they would have the ability to go in and actually monitor and drive by and see if there's abuse by the establishment, that they can actually start issuing citations and get people to actually obey and they have the ultimate power. These are liquor stores. They have a liquor license, and it has to go through the Liquor Control Commission. If you're found violating it, you could lose your license. I mean, it's a pretty powerful thing. And that just means somebody has to go in and actually report it, and then it can go directly to the Liquor Control Commission. They have a hearing, and you could lose your license. It could be suspended for 30, 60, 90 days, and it could have a pretty dramatic effect. I mean, there is a way to impact it. What's complicating it is that I know the lotto machines are in there, and people congregate around the lotto machines and things like that, which hasn't helped the situation as well. But there is a way to actually impact this if the enforcement agencies want to do it regarding their licenses.
But we got to get organized and do it ourselves. I don't wait on no system. Something affects our community. Men's got to stand up and take a stand and say no more of the hell with what the law says. Okay, the law, the hell with the law say, okay? In 1982, I had a meeting with a merchandise company I was working with, Michael Jackson, the Off the Wall Tour. And I ran the merchandise with them, watching them make $2 million a day off the black community. I went to Michael Jackson myself to sit down and say, why does everything got to be controlled? The merchandise, the blacks can't have any say or any ownership in the merchandise. They fired me off the tour, but let me tell you what I did. I organized and came back, and guess what? They punished me to leave the tour because they said I was a threat to the tour organizers. I organized my people, and guess what? I got my own merchandise company going and made them finance it. And today, my family owned $3 million in land because I stood up. Don't tell me what we can't do. We must not allow this, and men's got to come together to hell with the law. Go to any liquor store, we want them shut down. Hell with the consequences. When your baby's dying and people in your community suffering, you don't wait on no death. You think this would go on in a white community if people was hanging all out and they selling liquor every corner? Why all this have to be only in our community? This got to be allowed out of fear. Okay. We got to stop this. And the people in the store, they look at council. I'm going to give you the place. Nottingham, I'm not investigating. 18, 15-year-old kids going there.
Okay. All right. Well, we appreciate it. We have another call on the line. I believe Nathan. Nathan, you're on.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
It was a blessing to wake up this morning and find out I can watch the 5 and 6 o'clock news now. The producer, the cast of this daily reality show, what was predicated on lies and misinformation. I guess they broke the camel's back when he bought up the bleach. I hope they're not in a pool and go out there and shoot that bleach in their veins. If they ain't got no syringes, I got plenty of them. I give them a syringe. They can only just get the bleach.
I'm sorry. I didn't pick that up. Hello?
I think he said if Trump's got the syringe, he's got the bleach or something.
Okay. Well, yeah, I mean, it was sort of a wild situation where he's describing using Lysol to purge your lungs or something.
I like his ultraviolet light idea. I think that was pretty amusing because I'm like, have you heard of sunscreen? Why are people wearing that? And why were people worried about the ozone layer a few years back? I suppose if we, like, fly some rockets kind of right through the ionosphere and keep them flying around with lots of fuel belching out, they could, like, thin out the
I think the Republicans finally, their last call was in suggesting the Lysol or the bleach helping with people. I mean, it was just, it's indefensible. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense. And the tragic part is if somebody would have tried it at that point, you have somebody dying because of this. It doesn't make any sense. We have another caller on the line. Jerry, you're on.
Good morning.
Good morning, Jerry.
Good morning.
How about you?
And thank God you guys are safe and sound, and thank God for that. Mr. Robert Ficano, respond to the gentleman who was criticized at the Chaldean liquor store in Detroit metropolitan area, I just want to tell this gentleman, with my respect to you, I'm one of the people who went to the Kroger grocery store a couple of days ago, and there was about at least 50 customers inside the supermarket. And I was one among the people who doesn't wear a mask, doesn't wear a glove. And I saw, out of those 50 people, maybe 7-8 people with a mask, and the rest of them, they were not. And about the social distance, I did not see any instruction by the official at the grocery store to tell people keep destination. So it's not just the Chaldean. Don't attack that, just the Chaldean community and the liquor store. Try to be fair and try to make sense what some people say. Right away, the accusation, the Chaldean, the Arab. This is not right. In the meantime, Mr. Robert Ficano, to you and to your guests, I want to say something, and I would love your response. I do believe, yes, what the governor is doing, she's doing it because she's the in charge of our great state of Michigan, and she cares about the safety of our citizens. But my conclusion, Mr. Robert Ficano, and I want your guests to respond, I do believe coronavirus is in the air. It doesn't matter where you are at. If you are in a high-rise building with 100 floor high, if you are at the bottom of the basement or a shelter, it's in the air. The corona is there. But it depends, Mr. Robert Ficano, on the individual about your immunity. If your immunity is weak, the virus could control you. If your immunity is strong, you could pass it. So this is my idea as a personal idea. I would love the response from you and your guests. Thank you, and God bless you.
What was your idea? I'm sorry, what was your recommendation?
My recommendation is mask or a glove. To me, it's just too much panic. To me, you keep your hands clean. You use the soap and warm water for every time if you touch a doorknob, a building, you go grocery store, you come from any place else. Try to keep yourself in a clean zone. If you do those measures, I believe you don't need a mask. You don't need a glove. Mask, to me, I'm sorry to say that, is ugly. The mask remind me like as a people walking in a ghost town. And when I see people wearing the mask and the gloves, the way they look at me like I'm from a different planet. And I don't like this picture.
It's
not bad.
But Jerry,
But I let you respond. I don't like the mask. I don't like the gloves. If everybody keeps clean zone from his house, personal clean up everything, I believe we'll be safe because Corona is living in the air. It's there. It's there. What? I mean, no matter,
Jerry,
I'm sorry. The old saying, President Ronald Reagan, he said something. You could run, but you cannot hide. We are all...
Because you explain it as being, and it is, it's an airborne pathogen, the mask actually protects more because people, if they sneeze, they cough and things like that, not everybody does it into their elbow and things, and the mask is more effective in terms of blocking it from getting into the air and infecting other people. In fact, I think the executive order actually mandates now that if you go out, that you're supposed to have a mask in a number of situations. Culturally, we're probably one of the last nations that are comfortable with masks. If you go to other parts of the world, it's not uncommon to see them wearing masks and things like that. I know it's probably not the best fashion statement, but at the same time, we are facing a pandemic, and it's a way that will help lessen people actually catching it. And it, at the same time, allows you the freedom of moving within the community.
Yeah, excuse me for interrupting you. Month ago, or maybe more than that, I listened to some European doctor from some European country, and he's not just a doctor, he's a scientist. And they asked him about him, if he wore a mask. He said, no, I am not, and I'm a doctor. They say, doctor, why? What is the reason you said that? He said, when you wear a mask, actually, you are inhaling same air. It's been recycled to your body back and forth, and you are not allowing yourself to inhale a fresh air with oxygen. The mask will make you recycle the same air back and forth to your body. That's what he said, the scientist doctor from Europe. I'm sorry, I don't remember his name.
Yeah, I realize that, but you don't wear the mask all the time. You don't wear it at home. You don't wear the thing. It's only with social contact, like when you go to the grocery store. So, I mean, for an hour, you have the mask on, and the rest of the time, you really don't. I mean, like, I have a mask. If I wear it, I don't wear it in the car. But, you know, I think it is mandated now. I don't know if anybody else on the panel actually has looked at that, but I think the mask is mandated now as part of the executive order.
Yeah, I agree with you. Washing your hands isn't going to do anything to protect you from airborne particulates, you know, small particles of water that have the virus in it that people exhale. And that's what he's saying. And so you got this vapor moving around, or this mist, that can travel a certain distance before it dissipates. And that's why I think the masks are helpful. I agree, by the way, about the gloves, however, because I was wearing them for a while, and it got to a point where I realized if I keep them on all the time, then it's no different than my hands, except I might wash them less often, in which case I probably would have been better off just having my bare hands and washing them in between contact.
If you wear them, though, Scotty, once you go into the store, you can throw them away, not on the ground, but you can, as soon as you walk out, you can throw them away. In theory, if you have, some type of hand sanitizer or something like that. I agree. Wearing the gloves in the house probably doesn't make as much sense. But if you actually go out, you go to a grocery store, you have a mask, you have the gloves, things you touch and things like that, then when you walk out of the grocery store, you can throw the gloves and the gloves away. Not the permanent gloves, but the temporary ones.
Mr. Robert Ficano and the gentleman, excuse me, I addressed the last question. My last question is the water department in the city of Detroit taking any measure to keep our water clean and protected from the coronavirus? Because water is our life. And without water, we are not there. So is the official at the Detroit Water and Sewer Department taking any measures to protect the water for our citizens? I would love your answer, and thank you, and God bless you.
Okay, thank you. I believe that it is not, Scotty or Tom or someone might know better, I don't think that the corona is actually viable in water to be transferred from one to the other. I'm not sure of that. But there are chemicals, I know, that they, like saline, that they put in the water that is supposed to help, you know, kill whatever type of bacteria and stuff like that is within the water. So I've not heard of any real cases or concerns about the water being tainted at all because of the virus. And so is it anybody?
No. Yeah, I don't know if it could be transmitted that way. I doubt it, though. It'd be scary.
Yeah, I don't think you can transport it that way. Okay, I believe we have one more call on the line here for this hour. Walter, and Juan.
Hey, Bob. Hey, welcome back, Walter. It's been months since I called your program, and as usual, you got the same hand-picked non-Republican panel. And is Willie Burton hiding, or is he asleep, or what? Because he ain't said one word. And that white guy you got in there, it was slamming Donald Trump and praising the government.
All of us are slamming Donald Trump. But go ahead.
But that one particular guy, what an idiot, man, whoever he is, that put down Donald Trump and praising the governor, wretched witness. By the way, we've got a new name
Walter, have you heard some of the stuff he said, like drinking bleach and stuff? I mean, it's off the wall.
Would you say Ficano?
Yeah, did you hear, like, the president talking about disinfectants like bleach and Lysol and that show? Injected into the
lobby. I talked already.
I heard it. Yeah, I heard it, and you're stretching the truth like all the fake news media is. He didn't say that. And
you're the one who said it.
Hey, Burton wants to speak up now, huh? Because he likes playing the race card. Go ahead, Burton.
Sir, thank you for calling 9:10 a.m. with your question. We're going to go on to our next caller. Please call back. Please tune in.
Every
morning from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Walter.
I don't know how anyone, if you're calling the press conferences fake news that the president actually is saying the things in, okay, but he did say it.
He did say it. I'm sorry, sir. Who's on the line? Go ahead. Hello. Who is this?
Hello. How are you today? And your guest.
Okay,
you know,
great.
I took the remark tongue-in-cheek. I heard the president when he made it. He didn't use the word ingesting. He used the word injecting. He was in reference to, they're talking about the testing that they were doing with the ultraviolet lights killing the germs. And if you listen to the remark at the time he said it, he did not say we should drink bleach or Lysol. He was asking her if there could be, and as they were doing different studies, if that's possible or if you can do that. He didn't say drink the bleach. He said injecting. He didn't say injecting.
Okay. Either way, it gets into your system and it's poison. Whether you drink it or get injected.
But he made this statement, it was like tongue-in-cheek. It wasn't like, go out and drink the bleach as it's being stated. But what the most I wanted to talk about is Governor Whitmer. And I wanted to know, what do you think of, you know, she started, when she asked for help for our state of Michigan, she criticized the president in the first letter. So he responded back. Then she wore the T-shirts a couple different occasions. Right after that, we lose the F-35s coming to Michigan. The $89 million military jets. And I wonder, what does that represent, the loss to our economy? It seemed like when the president visited Michigan and he was over at the Dana Corporation in Van Dyke, Sterling Heights, he was recommitting that we were going to get the F-35s to Selfridge. I have heard some talk that Selfridge may end up closing down. What do you think this may play a part of the loss of her stature when voting time comes around? Just maybe you would have a better insight about the loss of the 35 M35 stuff. Excuse me, F-35 jet. All right, Connie.
You raise an interesting issue, because the simple truth of it is that the loss of that for the state of Michigan has been buried in the corona coverage. I mean, it's been corona 24/7. And I think people, I don't know what commitments the president made when he was in about what was going to happen with, the new plane being actually developed or manufactured there. And I don't know. It's like politics, like anything else. I'm not sure if that decision wasn't made a long time ago. They have a panel. They have a recommendation. They have others that actually look at where it's going to be manufactured and where it's going to happen. I want Michigan to Burton to him, so I can't say that he just cavalieries, because he was mad at the governor that he wasn't going to allow it to go in. In fact, that would be a counterbalance, saying, look what I'm doing for you. In order to try to win the state. He only won it by 10,000 votes to begin with. So I'd be surprised if he were so callous to say, look, I'm not going to I'm going to deny you now because of what your governor said. But, he is a vindictive guy. It's hard to tell. I really don't know what went into that decision. We haven't heard much of it other than Michigan didn't get it.
The F-35... that this has been talked about ever since the Obama administration. Originally, they were going to go to another base in Michigan, then they were going to go to another base elsewhere in the Midwest, and then with Donald Trump, shortly after he became president back in 2017, he promised they would come here. We saw absolutely nothing. He then resurfaced that promise in 2019 after 2 years of inactivity. So would I say that any of that has to do with the governor? No. It seems to do with just Washington, D.C. defense politics. There's probably more defense contractors that they have to pay off in other congressional districts. With Selfridge closing, however, I don't think that that's a great risk because, one, that is a National Guard base. Two, they have an integrated Homeland Security Operations Center there that is very valuable for monitoring our northern border. Especially with drug interdiction, terrorism prevention, things like that. So Selfridge has a lot of uses, on top of the fact that Selfridge is also a location where they're looking to expand digital warfare. So how can we have cybersecurity in our military, cybersecurity folks, to counter the cyber attacks we get from Russia and China, as well as work with industry to better protect American networks?
Okay. All right. Well, we have Dale, right? We probably our last call for the hour. Dale, you're on the panel.
Yes. Thanks for taking my call. I was listening to some of the previous callers who were talking about the COVID-19 virus, and I figured I would go ahead and put my two cents in regarding the subject. I market a product that has been on the market for the past 20 years. Is listed in the physician's desk reference and its equivalent in Canada. And what it does, it allows the body to trigger a chemical which is called glutathione, which is essentially food for the immune system. And the one thing that one caller indicated was the weaker your immune system, the more susceptible you are to illnesses and viruses. This product here addresses that issue, okay? And it's been doing it for the last 20 years. Now, I'm not going to go ahead and claim that this will address the common virus because that would be irresponsible. But what I'd like to do is invite people to go to a website to where they can get the facts for themselves and make their own decision as to whether or not this product would be viable for them.
Okay, I appreciate that, and they can look it up on the website. Obviously, you got to go through testing with the Food and Drug Administration and things like that.
Can I give my website so people can go see for themselves?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay.
This has not been approved by the Food and Drug Administration, has it?
as a dietary food supplement it has, but it's not a drug.
I don't think they've approved dietary. I don't think the FDA approves dietary food supplements, but I could be wrong. That is one of the areas that they've been weak in.
You're right. As I indicated, it is listed in the physician's desk reference. Okay.
Okay.
And that in itself carries weight. Okay.
Yeah.
Now,
I appreciate it. What's your website? We got to go to break. We have to go to break. So, what's your website?
www.immunotech.com/Harold Morrow.
Okay. All right then. Well, we appreciate you. You have a great Sunday. Very much. We're going to go to break now, and you're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. Obviously, you can join us at 313-778-7600. We're scheduled to have State Representative Karen Whitsett, who has had some controversy follow her in the 9 o'clock hour. So we'll be right back after these messages. Everything's going to be all right. We're going to stay strong and keep it tight. I'll be there indeed.
Yes. Let me talk to you. See, when it feels like the sun ain't shining bright enough, it's like the devil's trying to work to give an idol up. And though I'm blessed, I still got to handle the things I go through. It's good to have a friend.
This is Reverend Shopton, and on the last Keeping It Real with Reverend Al Shopton.
Oh, I just don't count the votes. They're not there when the vote. They just get
I just answered you before, sir, that I know thousands of people that are in the rooms when the votes come in. Every candidate has people in the room. When I've run, I have people in the room. Everybody running is going to have people in the room when the count comes in. The question is making sure we get the right count. The count does not come from them counting ballots. The count comes through technology. This is not 1890. We're not having people at the courthouse standing in line or the schoolhouse and you see the ballot. The question is making sure you have the right voting companies, that they're not hacked or not in any way eliminated. You could have everybody in the world in the room. They will be in the room getting the wrong numbers. So keep it real daily with me, Al Shopton.
Are you drowning in debt? Struggling just to make minimum payments? It's not your fault. Serious debt can happen to anyone, but there is hope. Our debt-free program has helped thousands of good people, just like you, eliminate their credit card debt. Call us today, and we will dramatically reduce your credit card debt down to just a fraction of what you owe. The call is free. The consultation is free. Take control of your credit debt. Take control of your life again. Call now to see how our debt-free program can work for you.
Call 800-872-5230.
If you or a loved one underwent hernia surgery between 2010 and 2016 and then suffered serious complications, call right now. You may be entitled to financial compensation. Complications associated with PhysoMesh include chronic pain, infection, adhesions, mesh migration, reopening of the hernia, and other serious injuries. Call right now.
Call 1-800-799-2091. Again, that's 1-800-799-2091.
Attention! In July 2018, Bayer announced that it will be halting its sales of Assure. The Assure birth control may break or migrate after insertion, puncturing the fallopian tube, resulting in corrective surgery to remove the device. Thousands of women have reported debilitating health problems to the FDA. In April 2018, the FDA restricted sales of Assure to protect women and require that patients receive risk information.
Please call 800-425-9539.
Hi, I'm Hunter Ellis, and this is Atomic Beam USA. Another bright idea from Bulbhead, the ultra-bright, tough-grade flashlight that features tactical technology used by U.S. Special Forces. This flashlight has a feeble 125 lux output. The Atomic Beam USA has up to 5,000 lux. That's 40 times more. We're going to drop it hundreds of feet from this helicopter. It hits the tarmac, and it's still working. That's what I call a tough flashlight. Heavy downpours, mud puddles, even extreme temperatures are no match. You could spend over $100, or the Atomic Beam USA can be yours for just $19.99 with free lifetime guarantee. Order now, you can double it and get a second Atomic Beam USA. Just pay a separate fee, and we'll even ship them to you for free. Atomic Beam USA is just $19.99. Order now.
Call 1-800-638-2619 to get your Atomic Beam USA. Call now or go to atomicbeam.com. So call 1-800-638-2619. Deluxe version available. Order now.
We all love fried food, but the problem is all that excess oil and fat can cause you to become overweight. Well, now there's the Cook Light Aero Fryer, an amazing kitchen miracle that uses air to fry instead of oil, so you can have the same delicious flavor and crispiness of deep frying using little or no oil. Get that deep fried taste and crispiness with up to 70% fewer calories. Enjoy crispy, delicious fries with little or no oil, guilt-free onion rings, cheesy and delicious mozzarella sticks. Call now and bring the Cook Light Aero Fryer into your home, including the Cook Light Aero Fryer recipe book, the unique patented dual tray, air frying mesh basket and tongs, and stainless steel extender ring. You'll get it all for five easy payments of $29.95. Be one of the first 500 callers and get this 13-piece knife set, a $175 value, yours free. Try Cook Light Aero Fryer for 30 days. If you don't love it, send it back. But keep the 13-piece knife set as our gift to you. Order in the next 10 minutes and we'll include free shipping. Call now or go online to air2fry.com. That's air2fry.com.
WFDF Farmington Hills, Detroit, 910 AM Superstation, a division of Adele Media.
Good morning. You're listening to 910 AM Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. We're here also with Police Commissioner Willie Burton and Scotty Boman and Tom Choske. And we're fortunate this morning to be joined by Karen Whitsett, who is a state representative out of the city of Detroit. Has had some controversy concerning her congressional district. I believe yesterday voted to censor, but also has visited President Trump, has been in the White House and concerning some of the remedies that he has suggested with the Corona 19. And so, Karen, State Rep. Whitsett, we appreciate you joining us here this morning.
Oh, thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate it. It's very much an honor to be on your show.
Well, thank you. And I know that you've gone through some controversial times. Why don't we, just so the listeners know, tell us a little bit about what your experience has been, what happened with you and concerning President Trump, and then yesterday, I guess, with the congressional district and the action they took.
Well, I'll just speed up to March 31st when my husband and I were able to be tested for COVID-19. We were tested at the state fairground, and that was the day that my symptoms got excessively worse on that day. That was also the day that Governor Gretchen Whitmer put down an executive order that was misinterpreted by not only the physicians but also by pharmacists. So doctors were receiving, if they wrote a prescription for hydroxychloroquine, they were receiving letters stating that they were going to be sued. So that day, my symptoms after being tested became excessively worse. I went from 0 to 100, excessive headache, labored breathing, sweats, muscle aches. Just everything just went completely out of control, like I say, from 0 to 100, and this just came out of nowhere. Just walking from my living room to my bedroom, my breathing became excessively labored. I could feel my lungs filling up with fluid. At this time, I also knew that Sinai Grace Hospital, as well as Oakwood, Dearborn, were full to capacity, so there was nowhere for me to go. If you think about what other hospitals you can go to and you think about the time frame of getting there, getting in, getting seen, getting assessed, that's several hours that's going to take as well. So I didn't feel that I had a whole lot of time to make a decision. So I contacted my doctor that wrote the prescription for the testing for the COVID-19. And he had already said that he had just received another letter stating that he had a lawsuit against him for writing the prescription for hydroxychloroquine. I explained to him that he was misinterpreting the law, sent him the information proving that he was misinterpreting the law. You know, hey, how are you going to argue with a lawmaker about the law? And he still did not.
Karen, who sued him? Was it the state of Michigan?
It was the state of Michigan, yes.
Okay.
And so I contacted State Representative Yes, it was horrible, and I don't know how many other people suffered on that day, and that's what's very scary, or how many other people did not get the medication that needed it and subsequently passed away. State Representative Annette Glenn, who's a Republican, also called my doctor, spoke to him, same thing, pleaded the case. He would not budge. The lieutenant governor had his office call, pleaded the case. He still would not budge. He said that he would make a decision tomorrow. I said, well, tomorrow I won't be here. So I contacted Dr. Arsawala, and Dr. Arsawala, after doing a telephone conference with me, he agreed that I needed this immediately, wrote the prescription, knew what pharmacy I could get it filled at, and my husband was able to pick it up, and I had it within less than an hour.
So tell us who the doctor was that prescribed it.
Dr. Muhammad Arsawala. He's been on with me several times, and he's also in charge of the American Medical Association in the state of Michigan.
Yeah, he's head of the Medical Association from Michigan, right? Yeah.
So. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Go ahead.
So it's just been a battle ever since. I mean, I wanted to thank the president, just as if, I'm sure if the president of the United States pushed you from a piano falling on your head, I'm sure you would thank him for saving your life of not allowing a piano to be pushed over your head. I just said thank you, because if it wasn't for the fact that he had mentioned the drug and that other physicians were more knowledgeable and knew how to go around the system in order to be able to write the prescription for this medication and obtain it, which we obtained it from a CVS, then I would not be here today to even have this conversation with you. And I know other people want to say, oh, you have been in it for so long, you were going to be over it anyway. Until you walked in my shoes, until you know what I have gone through, you can't say that. You don't know what I was up against. You don't know how frightening this whole situation is, which is why we have so many people that go home that are turned away from the hospital and die.
So how was it arranged? And I saw a picture. I think you were in the White House. Were you with the president when you thanked him?
Yes. I definitely went to the White House to be able to thank him, along with other COVID survivors, along with my husband, who is also a COVID survivor. We had the opportunity to go and celebrate other COVID survivors who went through extraordinary circumstances to be on the other side of this. And it was a wonderful opportunity to be able to do so.
I really think it's a shame that we have the state getting between patients and their physicians seeking help at a time when you know, that kind of medical assistance and flexible response is necessary.
Yeah, we're playing politics with people's lives, and that is what I am adamant about. And I'm going to continue to be vocal about it. I'm not going to be silenced by the 13th Congressional District or anyone else when it comes down to black people's lives, period, down here in the city of Detroit. If people want to play politics, I'm going to do whatever is necessary, by any means necessary, to get us the help and the resources that we need, period. I'm not going to play these games with anyone else. I don't have time. People's lives are on the line. I've lost two family members 6 hours apart from each other. There's a little girl that died. She's old. We are losing people. People's lives will forever be changed. The number that you see on the television screen are not numbers. They are human lives. And they matter. And when this virus is over, people's lives will never be the same.
Representative Whitsett, has the governor's office contacted you? Or has anybody from the governor's office talked to you about any of this?
They talked to me by text message, so I don't call that a conversation.
Representative Whitsett, I want to applaud you for your bravery. I mean, you allocated and got resources right here to Michigan, right here in the city of Detroit, where resources is needed. The mayor didn't do it. The governor didn't do it. It was your visit to the White House that got resources right here. So I applaud you, and I feel sorry for the loss that you have. I believe you just mentioned you lost two relatives to COVID-19. And also, you just recently lost a House representative, a colleague of yours, Isaac Robinson.
Isaac Robinson. People, I guess they would have preferred that I was one of those that they put a black cloth on the desk. They would have preferred that than me to be out here vocal. But we raised $450,000 in less than 4 days, and that has resulted in over 388,680 meals for the city of Detroit.
Okay.
And we have been able to get PPE out. We are working. We are working. That is what this is all about, and getting resources to the city. I don't know what I'm not sure what the 13th Congressional has done, but I know what I'm doing.
Well, you're doing a great job right here serving Michiganders. You're doing a wonderful job right here in the city of Detroit. When I think of state representative Karen Whitsett, I'm thinking of the woman that got resources right here in the city of Detroit, America's poorest and blackest city. Right now, you got bodies stacked up at Sinai Grace Hospitals. They don't even have body bags. They're running out of ventilators. But it was Karen Whitsett, our state representative, that got resources right here in Detroit. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the people in the 9th State Rep District are most fortunate to have you.
Yeah. Thank you.
So Karen, how did the controversy evolve itself then into the 13th District? What was the logic in what happened yesterday?
I have not gotten a direct answer as far as the logic. I can tell you what's been quoted to me from the media when they have contacted me. And the logic is that how dare I have conversations with the President of the United States and the Vice President of the United States about the needs of the city of Detroit. I did not go through the proper channels, and I did not discuss with the governor or anyone else that is in charge about what the needs are of the state. I didn't go there to Michigan. I went there to celebrate surviving. I survived. My husband survived COVID-19. I didn't go there to discuss the state of Michigan. But I did, however, of course, use an opportunity to have a conversation about what the needs were in my city. Why wouldn't I? Yes, I am. And they were shocked and appalled about what is not happening in our city.
So,
but I'm an equal branch of the government, as I thought. I thought I'm an equal branch of the government, and I have every right to talk to the President of the United States just as they do, and I do not have to check in with the governor. And I
will
not check in with the governor or anyone else. I represent, just like she does, I represent 93,000 people. I have people who elected me. The 13th Congressional did not elect me. The governor did not elect me. And I have a right to speak on the behalf of the people of my district and the people of this city and this great state.
You know what? So initially it was a personal mission because you were celebrating having overcome the virus and you were advocating when you had the access to the president about what was necessary for the city of Detroit or things that you thought would have helped the city of Detroit as well.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Scotty, you were going to say something?
So why wouldn't I?
I didn't really have anything to add to that.
I'm sorry, what?
Oh, I didn't have anything to add to that.
Okay. We do have some callers. If you don't mind taking some calls here, Karen. One, you're on.
Hey, how's everyone? Thank y'all.
Yeah, good.
And I hope everybody's, well spirit and well health. And sister, I love you. I love you just for who you are, and the voice. And I just want to touch on something real quick because it's not going to be attacking anyone or something, but artificial intelligence is what you speak, and it's going to always live. So when someone is controlling what you say, and you can let like a water speak all this raggediness, it's going to always live. So AI is going to put that at the top, right? And it's going to put your black butt at the bottom. You see what I'm saying? So if you have a producer that is controlling what's said, he knows, IT person knows that this is going to be law again forever. They're taking over the brain, right? What the brain automatically does. I'm not accusing anyone. I'm just telling you what artificial intelligence, you know, 9-10. You know what I'm saying? That's the nine, that's the one digit. You get what I'm saying? That's AI. You get what I'm saying? All of this is coded. I'm not accusing anyone of anything, but be careful what you say and what you allow to get said. Because Walter is a truck driver. Who's to say he's not sabotaging loads coming in here? We don't have Lysol. We don't have a lot of things. So you promote yourself to certain things, like the lady is saying. I'm for the people. She's not getting on here. I'm a Democrat, and I'm going to be in a gang. That's algorithm, right? You know, people hide under algorithm with amendments, all this kind of stuff. What does your soul say? What does your soul say? That's what we want to hear.
Okay.
Thank you for calling. We've got to call it, but please call back.
Yeah, Reginald?
I understand what he's saying, and what he's saying is that, you know, there's a lot that's going on, and it is systematic where we don't have a lot of the things that we necessarily need. And that's what I am fighting for, and I'm drawing light and attention to, because it is very true. You know, if you don't shine the light on, and I'll just give you an example real quick. When I was in Mississippi right after Katrina, I promised myself that I would never allow this situation to happen again. I watched where after President Bush, was the route that he was told that he was going to take, I watched the route be cleaned up after Katrina so that he would not see how bad it was. I watched it with my own eyes, and they moved the stuff in 2 and 3 and 4 blocks so that he would not see how bad it was. So all he could say was how good things were progressing. And I said, if I was ever in a position again to be a voice, I would never allow that to happen again. And I'm in a position now to not allow that to happen again. And I will be that voice.
Okay. Well, we're going to take a break. We're going to, if you can stay with us for a couple more minutes, we have a couple other guests that are going to be coming on, but why don't you hold on for a couple more calls if you can, Karen, and we'll be right back after this, okay?
Okay.
Thank you. I'm going to take more time with you and be a friend to me. I made a decision that everything's going to be all right. Gonna stay strong and keep it tight. I'll be there indeed. Yes. Let me talk to you. See, when it feels like the sun ain't shining bright enough, it's like the devil's trying to work to give an idol up. And though I'm blessed, I still gotta handle the things I go through. It's good to have a friend with another perspective to show you. Someone you know that knows you and gives you motivation. Someone that you could go to and vent your frustrations. We always talk about our peeps, how we be everywhere. When you need them the most, are they really ever there? See, everything be all good when we be having fun. The difference is really needing a friend and having one. It's good when your people just there to help you problems and help you smile about it while finding a way to solve them. Look at here, let me keep it 100 and let me tell you how you hold me down is something I genuinely value. I got a clearer view, and being that you're always there for me, I'm here for you. I made a decision despite all the things that we go through. I'm gonna take my time with you. I'm saying, even though we probably link up every now and then with minimal combo, look, it's really good to see you, friend. Something I realize that I don't even have to mention is whether or not you got me, that's something I never question. Sometimes I feel the people I love don't appreciate me. And some I hate, you see the shit I've been going through lately. See, you was here when the shit started.
Hi, I'm Joan London with A Place for Mom. Over the years, we've helped thousands of families find senior care, and today's senior living communities have never been better. With amazing amenities like movie theaters, exercise rooms and swimming pools, public cafes, bars and bistros, even pet care services. And nobody understands your options like the advisors at A Place for Mom. These are local expert advisors that will partner with you to find the perfect place and determine the right level of care, whether that's just a helping hand or full-time memory care. Best of all, it's a free service. Call today, A Place for Mom. You know your family, we know senior living. Together, we'll make the right choice.
Call A Place for Mom right now to get our free ebook on financing senior care as well as a free referral for senior living communities in your area. Call 1-800-436-2907. That's 1-800-436-2907.
40 million. That's the number of free phones still available and the number of how many Americans can still get prescriptions free.
Free could be wonderful.
That's why I'm still working at 77 years old to pay off my prescriptions.
I needed to have a prescription filled and I had to leave because I couldn't afford it.
Call now and see what's available for you. Free prescriptions. Over 10 million people get prescriptions free and the program has expanded so another 40 million can. Free dental. Over 15,000 dentists have provided over $330 million in free dental work. Free cell phones. 40 million free cell phones are still available with free minutes and more.
Free cell phone would change my life right now because it is something I cannot afford to get.
Medical supplies like back braces, knee braces, and diabetic supplies may be covered too. The free RX Plus hotline has saved callers over $12 million on their prescription costs. These free programs are now available to 40 million more people. Call now.
Hi. I'm Dr. Jay Butler, Deputy Director for Infectious Diseases at CDC. I'd like to talk to you about the new virus that causes the disease COVID-19. If you are one of the people at increased risk for serious COVID-19 illness, it's especially important for you to take action to reduce the risk of getting COVID-19 now. Wash your hands often with soap and water for at least 20 seconds. Use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer with at least 60% alcohol if soap and water are not available. Cover your coughs or sneezes with a tissue, not your hands. Avoid contact with people who are sick. Clean and disinfect surfaces in your home, such as counters, tabletops, and doorknobs, to remove germs. For more information and the latest resources, please visit cdc.gov/COVID-19 or call 1-800-CDC-INFO. That's 1-800-232-4636.
Good morning. You're listening to 910 AM. My name is Robert Ficano. I'm with Police Commissioner Willie Burton, as well as Tom Choske and Scotty Boman. We have, as a guest right now, Karen Whitsett, who is a state representative and has been involved, obviously, with some of the controversy with the 13th District, as well as having been a COVID-19 survivor and visiting the president to thank him about that. Karen, before, I know we're scheduled to go to about 9:30 or so. We have another caller, if that's all right here. Reginald, I think you're on with the state rep.
Yeah, good morning, Bob, and to your co-host and to state rep. Thank you very much for everything that you've done. My name is Reginald Amos. I'm the president of Detroit is United LLC, Michigan LLC registered. Okay, look, what people need to understand is look at first, the state rep and her husband is a survivor. Number two, look at the resources that she's brought in after that meeting as a result of the meeting with the President of the United States. Three, the state rep, as she says, she is elected. She do not have to report to the governor, the mayor, and definitely she don't have to report to Jonathan Kinlock or anybody else in the 13th Congressional District. As far as speaking with the president, hell, John Conyers, when he was a congressman, he spoke with several presidents. He didn't get permission from anybody in the 13th. So I would like for the state rep to go through the resources that she brought in through her efforts that the governor and the mayor didn't bring in for our police, our Wayne County Sheriff, our fire, our DOT workers. Detroit clearly was not prepared for this pandemic. Detroit have an emergency management / homeland security director that lives in Macomb County by the name of Lawrence Meyer. The city of Detroit is not prepared, okay? Wayne County have a disaster homeland security director by the name of Teradol, a third of it. These guys are paid over $100,000 a year. The city and Wayne County was unprepared. So there's no need for anyone to be talking about censoring this state rep for helping the people, because that's what they're actually saying. And Kinlock, when he went and made the deal with the mayor and Governor Snyder to deny Detroiters the right to vote, nobody censored him. So, State Rep, I appreciate if you give me a call, 313-399-8290. And again,
say that number again. What's the number again?
313-399-8290.
Okay, no problem. I'll give you a call.
Thank you very much, and you take care. And if there's anything I can do to help you, please don't hesitate to call me.
I will, because we have clinics coming up that'll be announced that I'm working with the White House to do right now.
Great. Fantastic.
Karen, have you received any word from the city administration, the city of Detroit, about any concerns about you going to see the president or any of the resources you brought back?
No concerns whatsoever. The mayor has told me he's very proud of me.
I'm sorry, say that again?
The mayor has told me he is very proud of me and what I've done.
Okay.
So no concerns at all. He's done nothing but give me a call and actually has wanted to go out with me as I've done deliveries of sanitation kits. You know, we've gotten a lot accomplished, from 20,000 blue masks, over, like I say, over 388,000 meals, sanitation kits that we were able to deliver to the Wayne County Sheriff's Department as well as the Detroit Police Department. We have another delivery that was Operation Blessings out of Virginia Beach. We have Kids Against Hunger that came in from Fox Valley, Illinois, in Minnesota. Lighthouse Charities that drove in from Galveston, Texas. We have another shipment of Foods for Kids. That was another 285,000 meals that came from Spokane, Washington. And we have a delivery that comes in on Monday from Lowe's so that we can get Lysol disinfectant, another 2,500 N95 masks, another 15,000 regular surgical masks. We have other 20,000 surgical masks. That's 25,000 gloves. I mean, the list goes on and on of what we've been able to get. I would have to collectively put all the numbers together, but we have a massive quantity to be able to distribute throughout the community and go into my senior buildings. And what I've done is I've given supplies to State Representative Sherry Gay Daniego, LaTanya Garrett, Tanisha Yancey, Wendell Bird, and State Representative Joelle Jones. So those are the people that I'm handing out supplies to so that they will be able to give and share with their district.
Okay. Just for a clarification, I know one of the news articles said Mr. Kinlock. Does he still work for the governor?
I have no idea. I don't keep track of him.
Okay. I know he's on the board of Mars. I'm sorry, what?
I do a Kinlock on the Board of Canvassers in Wayne County.
Wayne County, okay. All right. Well, Karen, we appreciate you coming on with us. That's State Representative Karen Whitsett and all that you've done and your trials and tribulations of getting through, but it sounds like you're really pushing to help Detroiters as much as you can to get through this pandemic. And I know it's not easy. And,
but I'm looking forward to it.
The job.
I'll keep you guys posted. We will have some clinics coming forward through the White House that will be local in our area so that people can get tested. So I will keep you posted about those as well. Those are coming up. We will have at least 6 locations.
Representative, I want to say thank you for being a champion for the people.
Thank you.
All right. We appreciate it. Okay. Thank you. Good luck to you. And we appreciate you coming along with us here at 9:10 a.m.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Have a good one. Bye.
You too. Next up, we have Mr. Rick Ross, who is a business person and how he's been impacted by some of his activity and some of his thoughts on
he sees going on. He's active not only, I believe, in Michigan, but also in California as well. Mr. Roth?
Nope, that case decided to reschedule, and you actually have Attorney Benjamin Crump on the line.
Oh, okay. That's great. Mr. Crump, then, I know you're rescheduled for 9:30. Mr. Crump, welcome. I know you're a distinguished attorney, and some of the things that with Trayvon Martin and some of the other people that you have represented in the past, and I know that you have some indications of what you see in the disproportionate amount of help or aid that there has come about with responses, in particularly in the urban areas like Detroit, that just have really shown the disparity in what's happened with African-Americans and in particular those that are in cities such as Detroit, where the pandemic seems to have hit a lot harder in terms of especially death and being infected versus other parts of the state and other parts of the country. So give us some of your thoughts on some of this.
Certainly. Thank you so much for having me this morning. And it's really alarming when you think about the disproportionate aspects, how this is impacting communities of color, especially African Americans. It has been long stated and just a general accepted truth that when white America gets the flu, black America gets pneumonia. And I illustrated in my book, Open Season, The Legalized Genocide of Colored People, that for whatever reason, the dynamic is always the same. It doesn't matter what fact pattern you present, what the issues are. Disenfranchised, marginalized communities of color always get the most of injustice and the least of justice, no matter what the situation is. And we see this playing out in just dramatic ways right now. Step aside for a moment, talking about how it's tragically killing us. Look at what just happened in the last weeks in America when it related to the stimulus and the bailout for what was supposed to be small businesses. You see that everything went to the privileged, the people who had resources, the people who had influence, and yet again, sitting on the outside of the fence was marginalized people of color. And that is just a prime example of what we're dealing with. When you go to the actual health care of trying to assist people who have contracted the coronavirus, it is just devastating for black and brown people, especially those who don't have adequate health insurance. They're not even being allowed into the hospitals, much less getting on ventilators or any of the other life-saving apparatus that could help us extend our lives to deal with this crisis. They're literally on their own. And so it just goes on and on, Robert. I look at the fact that we have Amazon workers calling my law firm, Walmart workers, who feel like they are not being provided safe working conditions, but yet they are being forced to come to work because it is essential for them to be able to pay their bills, to keep a roof over their head, to keep food on the table. And so staying home isn't an option for them. It's a luxury for a lot of people to stay at home, but for poor people in the lower socioeconomic communities, they have to work or they lose everything. And so it's just a vicious cycle that has been exposed by COVID-19 in dramatic ways.
To me, it's interesting. It's sort of sad that a lot of the frontline workers, whether you work at a grocery store such as Myers or Kroger's and things, that there wasn't a way that they actually handed out masks masks and gloves to people that you thought would have been the natural thing to do just to protect their employees. Initially, I don't think that was being done. I don't know if it's being done now because of the mandate, I believe, from the governor. But initially, there was no mandate of it, and it just sort of exposed everybody. If people walked into the store and they were, you know, have the virus, the odds were greater that you were going to be exposed to it by working there. It seems ridiculous that they didn't at least have a policy to try to protect some of the workers.
Yeah, I don't think initially they were doing anything to protect the minimum wage workers. I know the issue with Amazon took a big, I guess, media dynamic when the young man, a young brother, started a strike and called.
Yeah, that was out of New York and New Jersey.
Yeah. And so that really exposed just the basic lack of consideration for the employees. Amazon making record profits. I mean, everybody's stay at home ordering everything to the house, but yet these employees who say, we want to close down for just 12 hours to make sure everything is sanitized, to make sure everything is safe, so we don't contract this deadly virus, and worse, take it home and expose it to our families. And so even that basic request seemed to be shunned when asked by the frontline employees there at Amazon, making sure people got their packages. And so you look at that aspect. But then I often think it comes down to the same thing that we've always known. We are only going to be able to advocate for our people and give voice to our people and understand the issues regarding our people because others simply don't seem to care. And so when we adopt the mentality that we got to be responsible for saving us, then we got to start educating ourselves, engaging with our communities and empowering our people, whether it's our churches, our civic groups, our fraternal organizations, whatever it may be. We got to make sure people are not ignorant to the facts about this coronavirus. And so when I wrote the op-ed for USA Today, I put all those examples in there that we have to go educate our brothers and sisters that, no, it's not just affecting older people. That is a untruth. It's affecting people who have underlying health conditions. Now, most old people have underlying health conditions, the elderly, but there are a lot of people in our community who have the underlying health conditions of asthma and diabetes and hypertension.
At a much younger age than the general population.
Much younger age, and so we got to tell them. I know I have family members, these late teens, early 20s, they feel invincible. And so they think that, well, you know, I'm fine. It's not going to affect me. But they don't look at the family history that we have diabetes that runs in our family. We have high blood pressure that runs in our family. So you have to be careful to make sure that some of those underlying health conditions haven't started affecting you. And most of them don't know. And that's why you're seeing 30-year-old black and brown people succumb to this COVID-19 crisis, whereas you see many people saying, no, it only starts much older. That's only if you have those underlying health factors that don't affect you and your family. And then we look at just our brothers and sisters who are locked away in jails or prisons who can't social distance. I know my law firm represents the family of Michelle Duval, which is just the most tragic circumstances that highlight all the injustice that deals with marginalized people of color. She's in a prison, in federal prison in Danbury, Connecticut. And, you know, Attorney General William Barr came out and said that they're going to institute this policy for compassionate release for low-level nonviolent drug offenders. And when you look at what that would affect, when you look at Ticket's technical definitions, it would release almost 40% of white men and only 7% of black men by the way they had defined sentences to black people. They trumped up all the charges when it came to black and brown people, kind of like Michelle Duval, who had a substance problem. She had an addiction problem. That was her only crime. They raided a house where she was at in 2009. She was a convicted felon. There was a non-operable gun in the house. It had incense in it. They charged everybody in the house with having the illegal drugs and so forth. And then they, because the law said you can't charge everybody, they end up dropping all the charges against her on the drug charges, but they charged her with possession of a firearm by a convicted felon because she would not tell or implicate other people in the house. And so she then got the book thrown at her. They put her in prison for 15 years for being a person just in the house where an inoperable gun was found. So this sister has three sons. She's overweight. She has diabetes. She has high blood pressure. She is the, you know, example they tell you about why you have to be careful not to get this virus. She's in the federal penitentiary. She contracts the virus. She asks for a compassionate release. Well, guess what the Bureau of Prisons say at the Department of Justice? Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Ball, but because of your sentence of possession of a firearm by a convicted felon, you are a violent offender, so we can't release you. There is nothing in the record that says this woman has ever done anything violent except that she had an addiction problem. And now we treat white people with addiction problems with this opioids a lot different than we treat black and brown people. And so it underlines the fact that what we are having to fight a dramatic battle to get Michelle Duval out of prison so she don't die in prison. When you see Cohen and all these other white people getting out of prison under compassionate release policy.
What was the felony that she was convicted of that would make it a felon in possession of a firearm?
She had two previous arrests for possession of marijuana and possession of crack. And so those happened in 2005 and 2006. And then in 2009, she was found in that house. And that's when they gave her 15 years, even though she had never been in jail. She had always
been in jail. What was the violent offense?
I'm sorry, Patty?
Yeah, it doesn't sound like there was a violent offense at all.
I just, you look at how when poor people of color go before the courts, they will find the worst thing they can charge them with. Whether it's, little white boys and girls who have addiction issues, they go and they treat it like a mental health issue. But when there's people of color, they treat it like a criminal issue. I represent about 8,000 citizens in Flint, Michigan, in the water crisis. And we know that the science tells us this lead poisoning that came from the contaminated Flint River, that the government deliberately switched the water supply for this majority-minority community in 2014, and it stayed that way until the end of 2017. So you had all these children and citizens being exposed to this lead contamination. And we know that the science tells us it's devastating for children because it stunts the development of the brain. So many of these children are going to be special needs children when they get to high school. They're going to have attention deficit disorder. They're going to be intellectually challenged. And so when they become 18, 22, 25, and they having these mental health issues, we can predict, based on precedents in America, they're not going to treat these black children and these black young people as victims of mental health issues. They're going to treat them as criminal issues, and they're going to send them to prison to deal with the mental health issues. And it's just devastating over and over again what happens. And so we got to keep sounding the alarm, and we got to keep trying to tell our community what is really going on, make sure they're educated, make sure they're engaged, make sure they're empowered to say that our lives matter and our children's futures matter.
We have some callers, if you don't mind, Benjamin. Jalen, you on?
Sure.
Attorney Crump.
Good morning.
Good morning. What's on your mind, Jalen?
Yes, he decided he didn't want to ask his question.
Okay. He was on there for a minute anyway. He might call back. Benjamin, what do you think about it? They're talking about it's now been 6 years since the Flint water crisis, and I guess one of the issues that has come up is that there has been no real accountability in terms of state operators that thrust this into Flint in terms of switching the water. Are you concerned? I guess I read some of the articles about it, and I see the Attorney General's talking about, well, she thinks that perhaps the statute of limitations might be told because of the virus. I'm not convinced that can really happen per se, because you can, you know, she can always try to obtain a warrant. So any thoughts on that? And we're 6 years, do you think that we've gone past the statute of limitations now in charging some of these people, including the governor, ex-governor?
Well, certainly. Two things on that. Number one, we're in intense litigation on the civil matter to try to get compensation for these families. Now, if this would have been a more affluent community or a whiter community, you would be talking billions upon billions of dollars for making their children, you know, special needs children. But because it's a majority-minority community, they are trying to devalue the life and the life experiences of people of color. So we're fighting that in the civil court, and we feel confident that once we get in the courtroom, that there will be some accountability on the civil level. As it relates to the criminal matter, that's a whole matter entirely different. The report came out about the ex-governor recently, all the allegations and the evidence saying that he knew even before they switched the water supply what the contamination levels were, Flynn, and why this was not a good idea, but they did it anyway. And so those things are going to play out. But the real thing that gets to me, gentlemen, is the fact that, you know, black and brown people for selling low-level amounts of drugs, whether it was, you know, cocaine, crack, ecstasy, whatever the case may be, marijuana, they would throw the book at black people. I think about marijuana since it has now been legalized in most of the states in America. You know, there are still people sitting in prison now for life for selling marijuana, a drug that has now been legalized. And I remember just being in courtrooms, and you would hear them giving these young black and brown people 10 years, 20 years, life in prison for selling marijuana. And now you have the government, and most states have legalized it, and so literally what you have is the government, mostly white men, are going to make billions and billions of dollars for selling marijuana now. And essentially, you have the government is going to be in the business of selling weed to make money to pay their bills. Now, when black and brown people were selling weed to make money to pay their bills, they put all of us in prison. And so we object to America making any profit off of selling marijuana until they let all the black people, all the brown people, and anybody else who's sitting in prison for selling marijuana, because it's just hypocrisy, and there is no way they can justify it other than racism. And so you look at that dynamic, and you look at Flint. They would always tell the little black and brown people when they convicted us in the courtrooms, we got to lock them up and throw away the key. We got to send a message, because they poisoning the community. They poisoning the community. They would say that over and over again. And now you come to Flint, Michigan, where they actually did poison the entire community, and nobody goes to prison.
Yeah, what's interesting about that, I had to be in an office during that time, going through the bankruptcy in Detroit, is that the governor, at that time, Governor Snyder, actually controlled both emergency managers, which was interesting, because you had Kevin Orr that was in Detroit, you had the emergency manager that was up in Flint, and even Orr went to the governor, from what I understand, and said, don't do this. You're having Flint opt out of the Detroit water system, and that's not from a financial standpoint, that's not going to be good. But also there was a concern about how healthy this actually was going to be because they were drawing in from the lake that was around Flint, which obviously leached with the lead and has caused so many of these issues. So the governor actually had control over both emergency managers. And didn't really, he could have simply told one of the emergency managers, we're not doing this, at least the one in Flint, and it would have been over with. I mean, it wouldn't have happened. But they went ahead and they see the results of it 6 years later and what's really happened with it. You think there's going to be any criminal convictions in this?
You know, it's so funny what you say about the governor having control and they trying to point fingers at different people. Again, if this was a more affluent community, a whiter community, lightning would strike and thunder would roll. I mean, there would be people going to prison left and right. Just think about it. Just oppose the opioid crisis that's going on in America. How many doctors have went to prison now for prescribing opioids to suburban white people? And it just goes, what I demonstrate in the book, I talk about the fact that black men only make up 7% of the population in America, but in many states, black men make up 50% of the population on death row. And quite literally, the quickest way to get to death row in America is one of two ways. Number one, it is to be a person of color and to kill a white person. And then number two, it is to be a person of color and be accused of killing a white person. Quickest way to get to death row in America. But when you just oppose that, and it's a white person who kills a person of color, there's no guarantee they're even going to prison, let's get on death row. And because of these Jim Crow racist stand your ground laws, there's no guarantee they'll even be arrested. They kill people in our communities and go home and sleep in their bed at night. And so when we talk about what happened in Flint, you know, it just underscores and illustrates again for us that the value of life for people of color in America is marginalized, whereas there is a value of white people in America that is absolutely given the greatest consideration possible, no matter who the white person is. And so will people go to jail in Flint? We have to scream from the top of the mountain that they should not get away with being able to sweep our deaths and our lives under the rug. And that's the only way it has a chance of happening. If we use our voice, if we don't use our voice, ain't nothing gonna happen.
Attorney Benjamin Crump, it's an honor to have you on the Robert Ficano Show here at 9, 10 a.m. We'd like to give you an invitation to come back next week for a full hour at 9 o'clock We're going to have Freeway Ricky Ross on. We want to have you back on with us. Talk about racism, disparities, and also more about the Flint water crisis, because somebody needs to be held accountable. Are you welcome to come back on next week with us?
I certainly hope so. I have to get with my associate, make sure I don't have a conflict, but I look forward to it.
Okay. All right. We'll see how we'll be able to work it out here and see what happens. So I want to thank everybody. Thanks very, very much, Attorney Benjamin Crump. I appreciate you coming on and expressing your views and everything. You're also an author of a book. I think that's about to come out or has come out as well. So what's the name of the book?
It has come out. They can order it for online, Open Seas and the Legalized Genocide of Colored People. And thank you so much for using your voice and your platform to help uplift the community.
You got it. Thank you. I want to thank everybody for coming on today, all our guests. And I also want to thank Willie, Scotty, and Tom for being part of it. And I appreciate it very, very much. And we're going to be back with you next week from 8 to 10. You're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano, and we want to wish you not only a great Sunday, but a great week, and make the best out of this as we can under the circumstances. Listen to you, or we'll be with you next week. Got me, that's something I never question. Sometimes I feel the people I love don't appreciate me. And some of hate you see the shit I've been going through lately. See, you was here when the shit started to haywire. You're still here walking with me. The day you lose your strength is the day you lose your independence. Muscle is lost with age, affecting your energy, balance, and mobility. Before you know it, you're depending on others just to get through the day. But you can reverse and prevent muscle loss. Introducing MyoHealth, a revolutionary proven approach to increased muscle strength and function in as little as 30 days. Live life on your terms with more energy and confidence.
After a serious health issue put me down, MyoHealth's getting me back up again.
I'm doing activities that I haven't done for a long time. It really works.
MyoHealth is a safe, natural dietary supplement, the result of decades of research and 24 human clinical studies. You can live stronger at any age with greater strength, mobility, balance, and energy. Call or go online now and take the MyoHealth 30-Day Strength Challenge.
So, you've decided to go to college. That's cool. So, pop quiz. Which is a better way to earn your degree? Commute to college and fill your gas tank, get stuck in traffic, drive in bad weather, try to find a parking space, walk a half mile to class, or learn online at Independence University. In the park on a bench, on the beach on a towel, or on your couch with your kid, your campus is wherever you want it to be. You don't go to college. College goes to you. That's Independence. That's Independence University. You schedule classes around your schedule, and all your supplies, including a brand new laptop and tablet, are included with tuition. At Independence U, you'll learn from professional instructors with real work experience. You'll get personal support in school and employment assistance when you graduate. Get your degree, but keep your life. That's Independence. That's Independence University. So if you're really smart, you'd call now.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Independence U, for an independent you.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Are you getting the most out of your Medicare plan? Are you sure? Many people with Medicare are eligible for plans that include extra benefits in addition to those found in original Medicare. Benefits like dental, vision, and prescription drug coverage. Call now to see if you're eligible to enroll. The consultation is free with no obligation to enroll. In addition to hospital and medical coverage, at no extra cost, you could also get coverage for prescription drugs, dental, hearing, vision, and...